So I'm here again at Prismic, and today I'm with Guillermo from Zayat. And I like particularly Zayat because of the strategical decisions that you're doing, especially with serverless and Next and what you're doing there. Not obvious choices, but I guess they are very interesting. The whole strategy is very interesting. And particularly, I would like to kind of talk more about the serverless topic. And, introduce people to what is it. So can you give us your definition, introduction of what serverless is?
Yeah, serverless is a way of deploying websites and application where the developer doesn't worry about infrastructure. The infrastructure is outside of the code. You don't write servers in your code, and you don't provision servers, which means there's no monitoring, no overhead. The servers are not running all the time, which means your code gets invoked completely on demand, which means you only pay for what you use. If you have 1 million hits of traffic to your website, you pay exactly for that, and then your code stops running.
Does it mean it's only about costs? It's only about cutting costs?
It's not only about cutting costs. It's about making development a lot easier. It's about making development a lot more error-free. So an example of serverless is your code is structured as what we call serverless functions. When a request comes in, a function is invoked, and the result of that function is returned to the user. And this is how web applications were created and structured for a very long time.
You're talking about PHP here.
For example. So PHP was, you'd write a bunch of files in the file system. You would FTP them. Nowadays, you push them into Git. And when your request comes in, that's when your code executes. So you do some logic, you talk to a database, you talk to a cache, you do some processing, and you return some HTML. But when you're iterating on your application, you're not worried about servers. The server is literally not there, which allows you to focus 100% literally on what your users are requesting.
Right. So basically, that means that you should not consider that you're running on the server. So you can't store files or things in memory and expect them to be back in the next request.
Yeah. So the question of state is very nuanced. So the idea of serverless functions is that they're not always running. So as a developer, you can't make an assumption of what's in memory. What resource am I connected to a database? You kind of have to always assume that you're starting from scratch. But that's also a very healthy thing because you write very robust code. You don't make assumptions that, my database is connected, therefore everything is okay. And then you get paged or you wake up at 3 a.m. that your website is down, you're getting pinged, you're getting tweets. And what do you do in those cases? You go and you reboot the server. That would never happen with serverless because the pattern doesn't allow you to assume that there is all this stuff already running or like a database already connected.
So meaning also you should be careful about startup time.
Yeah, so that's what we call the cold boot problem. So your serverless code or your serverless functions do have a life cycle. So when a request comes in, if your code has not run in a long time, a cold boot happens. You can think of it as starting an engine from cold. So when the cold boot happens, you connect to your database, you do everything the normal way. And then when you respond, the function, the instance of that code that you run gets frozen. And then when the next request comes in, the function comes back alive. But because it was frozen, it comes back alive very, very quickly. So that's where you do have an opportunity to save some state, but you should not rely on it.
Rely on it. Okay, cool. Well, on other videos, we'll dig more deeper into some other aspects about serverless, deploying in global, scalability, all of the other things. Thanks.